Okay, people, before I get really down and dirty with this bread talk, I want to make it very clear that there are two perspectives that are valid. The perspective that bread is good for us and the perspective that bread is bad for us. These are both valid perspectives, and at the end of this talk, I'm going to invite you to choose a perspective that is most empowering for you. And diving into this, we're going to start out with the perspective, finding evidence for the perspective that the bread is good for us. We're going to find 10 reasons I'm going over why it might be good for us. And next, secondly, I'll go over 8 reasons why bread might be bad for us. So these are both valid perspectives. Neither of them have more or less weight of evidence. It really does come down to you, you unique you, and what is most empowering, okay? If you do not already know me, my name is Katie Rhines. I'm a plant-based registered dietitian and food freedom and body image coach. I freaking love helping women feel confident, strong, and healthy with a plant-based diet. If you are interested at all in nutritional counseling or food freedom and body image coaching, please do click the link below to apply for an initial free consultation so that we can get to know each other and see if we're a good fit to work together. Okay, I'm gonna go over 8 reasons why bread is not healthy for us. However, before I get started, please do know that balance in this life is very healthy, very important. So if you are traveling, if you are celebrating, if you are feeling really damn stressed, you just got dumped, whatever, and you just want some damn white bread, like, balance is important. Obviously, if you're chronically traveling, eating out way too much, and using food and bread and carbs to cope with your emotions for the long term, please do seek help for that. However, once in a while, like, having some balance, having some moderation with this is really holistically healthy. We want to be able to live our life. We want to be able to experience all the bread that we want to experience while having a healthy, balanced lifestyle, okay? So with that said, let's go over 8 ways bread might be unhealthy for us. Number one, if it's white bread that has so many preservatives in it that it's been on the shelf for 20 years and it still looks exactly the same. This is not going to be good for us. Like I said before, the whiter the bread, the sooner you're dead. White bread basically means that it's been stripped away of essential nutrients and the bran and the germ of it is stripped away, and it could be bleached. Since the bran and the germ have been removed from the grain and it's been turned white for white bread, this means that there's less fiber intact there. So where there's less fiber, that means there's going to be more of a blood sugar spike. Okay, pause real quick. White bread definitely does have a place. It's so important to decrease our fiber, say if we're an athlete or if we're overcoming an eating disorder. Having less fiber is actually really beneficial, which I will discuss later on. Just know that there's no blanket statement that says white bread is bad or whole grain bread is good. Basically, in general, it is beneficial for our gut microbiota to have more fiber. However, I'll discuss later on the nuances of this. So our blood sugar is going to go up from this quickly absorbed white bread. It's going to go up, and then our blood sugar is going to crash even lower than it was before. This is going to lead to fatigue, mood swings, headaches, and just overall cravings for more carbs. There are ways to hack this response. For example, if you combine your white bread with a source of fiber, source of protein, a source of fat, and be sure to eat your source of protein and fiber first, that is going to blunt the blood sugar spike from white bread. Also, blueberries have been shown to blunt the blood sugar spike, and resistant starch from beans can even help with this as well. So just eating white bread with your meals, it's not the worst thing, right? When it comes to choosing a bread to eat, on the day-to-day, it's a good idea to choose options I mentioned before, like the Ezekiel brand, a whole grain brand. But once in a while, if you want to have some white bread, more power to you. However, you don't want to be spiking and crashing all of the time and having this roller coaster of blood sugar, so I don't recommend the white bread. Number two is when you toast your bread to the point that it's black. Blackened bread, that shows, that's a visual of what AGEs, advanced glycation end products, looks like. There's definitely way more AGEs in things like blackened meat, but still, blackened bread does create free radicals, which causes an oxidative stress response in the body. body, leading to inflammation. And this could lead to things like colds and premature aging and wrinkles, hair loss, etc., etc., etc. We don't want to have an oxidative stress response in the body. We want anti-inflammatory. I do recommend in general to eat our water, and that means eating high water content foods. Obviously, bread is baked, so bread is something that's low in water content, and it's definitely going to be worse and worse and worse the more and more black and dry the bread gets. So if you really, really like your bread black, please try to toast it a little bit less than black. That's gonna be a lot better, okay? So we don't wanna eat too many AGEs. There's also research around things like PCOS and diabetes, other inflammatory issues improving when we reduce the AGEs in our diet. So let's not have black toast when we have our bread. This brings me to number three, which is when you are extremely dehydrated. A lot of people confuse thirst for hunger, and they'll say, oh, I have carbohydrate cravings, or oh, I'm tired, like I just want bread. Maybe you are just thirsty, all right? So drink plenty of water, and then bread will be a lot better for you than if you are just tired, dehydrated, and eating lots of bread. You're gonna end up being constipated and not feeling good at all. So make sure you are hydrated. The fourth reason why bread might be bad for us is if we have a compromised gut. So if we have an irritable bowel disease like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis and open ulcers in our GI tract, having any food that's high in fiber is going to cause serious irritation in our gut, and probably we're going to experience bloody diarrhea, pain, discomfort. It's not going to feel good, okay? So this is like diverticulitis. If you have polyps in your colon and they're inflamed and you have lots of fiber, that thick snake of a number two that is gonna wanna pass isn't gonna be able to because your gut is so screwed up and inflamed, all right? We want to make sure that our gut is on folic, which is important for us to eat lots of fiber. However, if you've been really not eating enough fiber and you've been really constipated for years and years and years, you may experience something like IBD, irritable bowel disease, or diverticulosis. And with these situations, what's recommended is a low fiber diet. My protocol with this is, instead of nixing all of the fiber altogether, I do recommend a bed rest for 2 weeks with a juice fast. So make sure that you let your gut heal for 2 weeks with a double strained green juice fast. And this is a juice feast, people. Make sure you're drinking plenty of juice. And then slowly, 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 once you have your symptoms are gone as far as having bloody diarrhea, making sure that you're slowly introducing fiber with things like pureed soups and smoothies, and slowly making sure you're building your way up to a high fiber, plant-based, high antioxidant, immune-boosting diet, all right? That's my protocol for IBD, and I highly, highly recommend you follow this instead of just completely cutting out all plant foods and not flooding your body with antioxidants. So basically what I'm saying is if your gut is compromised, please don't eat high-fiber breads. If your gut is compromised and you're not able to do bed rest and you're not able to juice feast and really properly heal your gut, the lower fiber breads are what is recommended, okay? Number five reason why bread is not good for you is when you are sensitive to lectins. So if you're sensitive to anti-nutrients like lectins, like before I mentioned phytic acid, in the book, The Plant Paradox, he describes, Dr. Gundry describes how he's had a lot of success with his patients from removing certain plants that are high in lectins and anti-nutrients. These people were able to really reduce inflammation by removing certain foods from their lifestyle. Phytic acid can actually prevent absorption of minerals like zinc and iron. However, when we soak and we sprout our grains, that reduces the phytic acid and makes it so that we can more easily and readily absorb zinc and iron. This also comes into play with other anti-nutrients. Things like lectins and tannins can also be removed. And if you think about the logic behind this, for example, if you think about the seed of an apple, if you just swallow the seed of an apple whole, then obviously you're going to see the seed come out in your number two, and that's brilliant for nature to make this like this so that the seed can germinate in the soil. However, if this seed was ground or was soaked and sprouted, when it's soaked and sprouted, then it starts to grow a little bit. And the anti-nutrients that are meant to keep it from digesting in our stomach, those anti-nutrients are there for a good reason. The anti-nutrients are there because these whole grains are a seed of a grass. So the seed of a grass wants to not be digested until it's watered, until it's in the dirt and it's given some water so that the nutrients can come out to support this grass that's gonna grow, whether it be wheat grass or barley grass, oat grass, rye, whatever. These are all seeds of a grass, and the anti-nutrients are there so that it makes it through our digestive system. However, when it starts to germinate and it starts to sprout outside of our digestive system, then those nutrients become readily available, right? So those are going to make it a lot easier for us to digest and make those nutrients obviously more able to be utilized, okay? So, and that comes into play too when we're cooking rice, when we're cooking quinoa, when we're cooking buckwheat, different kinds of grains. It's a good idea to soak and sprout beforehand. If you're noticing that eating whole grains really does bother you, maybe it's not necessarily the grain, maybe it's the way it's produced, maybe it's the way that it's cooked. So there's a lot of things that can go into a reason why you might be feeling bloated or you might be having the situation that you're having around bread. Obviously, if you're sensitive to these things, it's not good for you. And I loved one point that he made in The Plant Paradox was that in Japan, where people are super, super healthy, they're not eating brown rice. They are eating lots of white rice. And as I said before, the whole grain in general, the vast majority of research shows that it's gonna be the whole grain, like the brown rice has the bran, the germ, and the endosperm versus being stripped of the outside bran in white rice. He says that the bran and the germ is what has all that anti-nutrients, which is going to prevent absorption, which is going to cause bloating. So some people are really not able to process these things. And I really do think it comes down to the health and the situation that your gut is in, whether or not you're able to properly utilize and absorb the fiber in these different grains. So if you are having sensitivities and if you are one of those few people who really are not able to process whole grains, then yeah, either having a lower fiber bread like a sourdough or a white bread or avoiding grains is going to be a good idea for you, all right? And this is something that you're gonna have to figure out for yourself because everybody is so, so, so different. Number six time that bread is bad for you is when you have celiac disease, when you are actually allergic to wheat, and when you really, truly do have an intolerance, just like I mentioned before in tip number five. And that brings me to number seven, which is when your DNA just don't want it. People from person to person are going to process foods differently. Some people, for some reason, for example, when you're monitoring blood glucose, some people do just fine with bananas, and some people, bananas make their blood sugar spike like crazy. Some people, same thing with grains, same thing with bread. Even if it's a whole grain bread, their body, their blood sugar just goes up. Like, people are so different, so depending on you, unique you, your intolerances, your DNA, your gut situation, your stress, like whatever's going on in your life, maybe bread is not the best thing for you. Lastly, number eight reason why bread is bad, why bread might be a bad thing to eat, is when you have shame, guilt, and fear around it. Just like I said in the last list, number 10, when you feel the shame and guilt and fear around bread, you are truly compromising your capacity to utilize this bread to its full potential to provide energy, to provide protein and fiber to your life, and you're making it an unhealthy food. So please do, next time you go and eat bread, take a deep breath and get so excited and grateful and be mindful of the sun and the soil and all the people that made it possible to get this bread to you today. Like, how magical is that? And stepping into that is going to make it much healthier, all right? So let's remove the guilt and bring in the gratitude. Oh, that was a mouthful. I'm so proud of you for making it through this video so far. I want to wrap it up by making sure that you feel so excited about choosing bread and feeling like oh my God, you know what? I get to decide. I get to decide that this is good for me or this is bad for me. Because at the end of the day, the most important thing is you feeling confident and grounded and grateful around your decision. When it comes to us making a decision around is bread good or bad, we cannot just ask this like this. What are you comparing it to? Are you comparing it to dirt? Kale, vitamin C content, fiber content? Are you allergic to it? Are you not allergic to it? Does it make you feel good? And are you an athlete? Are you a diabetic? So bread can be good or bad based on whatever works best for you. And I invite you to embrace balance, embrace lots of different foods in this life, and recognize that eating some bread is not the end of the world. We can truly come from an empowered place and decide that, oh my gosh, this bread is convenient, it's delicious, it's got protein, fiber, lots of complex carbs for me to feel amazing, and I'm so excited about eating it, or it makes me bloated and I don't want it. It makes me feel like crap. So you get to decide if bread is good or bad for you. So stop looking at places outside of yourself for the answers. You truly get to feel empowered in choosing the evidence that works for you, all right? If you're looking to lose weight, first of all, lots of studies have shown that when we focus on weight loss alone, it is not sustainable and it causes a lot of anxiety around food and body image issues. So instead of focusing on losing weight and the calories, I invite you to instead notice your energy, notice your stamina, notice how strong you feel and how great you feel after you eat this bread. I hope you learned a lot from this video. I hope you feel a lot more free and excited around eating bread or not eating bread and making it something that is an empowering decision for you. Please do comment below. Are you going to eat bread after this video? Tell me why or why not, and I would love to answer whatever questions you have around this. Again, my name is Katie Rhines. I love helping people navigate lots of food and body image issues. Hit me up on Instagram at vitamin.katie. If you have not yet subscribed to this channel, go ahead, hit that big red subscribe button and get excited for more videos to come. You are freaking amazing. I love you so much. Take a deep breath. Feel so grateful and alive today. I am so excited for you to feel empowered around bread. All right. Can't wait to read your comments below. Have a great day. Bye.